right, all right. Very good, very good. You know, you guys are excellent. No one has to scream. At least I don't. I appreciate that. So thank you, grade 6, 7, and 8 students, teachers, any parents. I don't think we have parents. Last assembly, we had some parents to come see their little ones. So they don't want to come see you guys. But anyway, we're going to do this anyway. So, you know, I'm just kidding, right? So Mr. Ash, who, first of all, welcome to Fellows School's annual Black History Month. I'm going to emcee this from Mr. Ash, who is in a meeting all day. So sit back, relax, learn something today. I actually learned some stuff from the last assembly from the little ones. So I hope you guys can teach me something as well. Probably not, but I'm going to be listening and see. So without further delay, I'm going to turn this over to our 8th grade student, Malaysia. She's going to come say a few words about Black History Month.
The month of February is observed as Black History Month. We use the month of February to remember and honor the important contributions and achievements of African Americans throughout history. The celebration can be found nationally and even worldwide, as many organizations, cities, states, and countries hold activities, events, and assembly programs such as this, which educate people on the rich culture and lingual figures of African American history. As this month of remembrance comes to a close, let's be sure to note all of the important reasons why Black History Month is observed each year. First, let's recognize Carter G. Woodson. In February of 1926, he was the sole person responsible for creating the first Black History Week in Washington, D.C. To Woodson, the history of African Americans and their culture was too important to be left to a small group of academics. He wanted to share it throughout his unique and first-hand perspective. Further, Woodson's primary goal was to ensure that all children were exposed to Black history in schools and other settings. Next, Woodson chose the second week of February in order to celebrate the birthdays of Abraham Lincoln and Frederick Douglass. The development of Black History Week from a week to a full month was proposed in February 1969, and by 1976, President Gerald R. Ford expanded it into a month. He said that the country needed to seize the opportunity to honor the too often overlooked accomplishments of African Americans in every area of endeavor throughout our history. That is why Black History Month is such an internal part of our national tradition. We must continue to promote positive examples of poignant historical events and leaders and step towards social change. The remembrance is not only deeply meaningful for the African American community, but it's important for the greater understanding of our history, both nationally and worldwide. Also, by revealing and remembering history, we create an awareness of the struggles and challenges that African Americans overcame in the country. And this is proven perseverance could serve as inspiration for all the diverse communities around our country and world. Lastly, by celebrating Black History Month, everyone can be included in the tradition and acknowledgement, inclusion, and community engagement. As the world continues to diversify the groups of many religions, cultures, and creeds, it is important as ever to celebrate the histories that make up the collective account of our nation. Not to mention, it's easy to take the rights we have for granted if we don't remember the determination an earlier generation showed. In the closing, as fellow students and leaders in our district and community, let this serve as impetus to grow, bringing forth challenge and reach even greater heights in the future.
Very good, Malaysia. Thank you. Okay, so here's what we're going to do. The agenda, we're going to go in order, and it's going to start with grade 6, room 304, Mrs. Lark. They're going to do the ABCs of HBU's 304, whenever you're ready. give him a hand.
There you go. I just had to turn the brightness down.
But it's backwards.
It won't be when it actually... It's backwards for us, but not for the people watching.
Hello, my name is Gia Shao from Room 04, and Room 04 wants to present the ABCs of HBCUs. Alphabetical. A stands for Alabama State University. Alabama State University received a notable increase in its rankings by U.S. News and World Reports. The publication recently released finds that measured undergraduate education quality among the nation's colleges and universities, including historically Black colleges and universities. B stands for Bluefield State College. The Bluefield State Honors Colleges offers an exciting opportunity for high-achieving students interested in an advanced level of academic engagement both inside and outside the classroom, making them more prepared and competitive in their future graduate studies and careers. C stands for Central Arizona College. Central Arizona College has 5 campuses and 3 centers. They are located throughout the country. The college also offers personnel growth opportunities for all ages. D stands for Delaware State University. People rank Delaware State University number 3. And E stands for extraordinary. There are many HBCUs that are extraordinary. Some examples are Spelman College, Howard University, and Hampton University.
F stands for University. Bedeville State University is best known for being affordable college, and in 2022 ranked 77 in best colleges in regional University South.
G is for Grambling State University. Grambling State University is a public historic of Black university in Grambling, Louisiana. The university is home of the Eddie G. Robinson Museum and is listed on the Louisiana African American Heritage Trail.
H stands for Hampton University. Hampton University is a private historical Black research university in Hampton, Virginia. Found in 1868 as Hampton Agriculture and Industrial School, it was established by Black and white leaders of the American Missionary Association after the American Civil War to provide education to people.
Interdenominational Theological Center.
Okay.
The Interdenominational Theological Center is a consortium of 5 predominantly African-American denominational Christian seminaries in Atlanta, Georgia, operating together as a professional graduate school in theology. It is the largest freestanding African-American theological school in the United States.
J stands for Johnson C. Smith University. Johnson C. Smith University is a private historically Black university in Charlotte, North Carolina. Johnson C. Smith University was established on April 7, 1867 as the Biddle Memorial Institute that started the Old Charlotte Presbyterian Church. K stands for Kentucky State University. Kentucky State University is a public, historically black land-granted university in Frankfort, Kentucky. Founded in 1886 as a state normal school for colored persons and becoming a land-granted of higher learning in Kentucky. L stands for Lincoln University. It was founded as a private Ashman Institute in 1854, but has been a public institute since 1972, and was the United States' first degree-granting HBCU. M stands for Morehouse College. Morehouse College is a private institution that was founded in 1867 at Morehouse Colleges, ranking in the 2022 edition of the Best Colleges in National Liberal Arts College, and is number 128.
And stand for
oh, here we go.
No.
Top key, get it together.
And stand for Norfolk State University. At Norfolk State University, your future starts here. We have a high expectation for you, and we need help. We help you achieve Norfolk University.
O stands for Oakwood University. The College Oakwood University is a private, historically black Seventh-day Adventist university in Huntsville, Alabama. It is owned and operated by the Seventh-day Adventist Church.
Good job.
P stands for private. Many of the HBCUs are private colleges or universities, meaning they rely more heavily on student tuition fees, alumni donations, and endowments to fund their academic programs.
Q stands for qualified. Everyone is qualified to attend the HBCU no matter what their race is.
R stands for Rust College. Rust College was established in 1866 by the Freedmen's Aid Society of the
Methodist. Episcopal. You got this, Steven. He's so hard on himself.
It's okay. Hey, come on, Ezekiel.
They're big words.
S is for spectacular. HBCUs are spectacular as they follow Black traditions, help people achieve many goals and achievements. HBCUs are generally good places to be. Tennessee State University National. Tennessee State University is the only state-funded HBCU college. U is for unite. HBCUs unite to promote leadership, scholarship, and social awareness while motivating and empowering the youth to dream and excel in every way possible. V is for University of the Virgin Islands. Do you know that HBCUs are located in the Virgin Islands of Troy and St. Thomas? There are various clubs on campus such as Alpha, Kappa Alpha, Delta Sigma, Theta Sorority, Rotary International Club, and many others that will pique your interest.
Yeah.
W is for what is a HBCU? HBCU is historically black colleges and universities are institutions of higher education in the United States that were established before the Civil Rights Act of 1964 with the intention of primarily serving the African American community.
Xavier University. Xavier University is a wonderful school founded by St. Catherine Drexel and the Sisters of the Blessed Sacrament. This university is Catholic and teaches about roles in society. Y is for you. You have to be at least 17 years old to be in college. These colleges attend to our youth by providing a good education. Z is for zeal. Great energy or enthusiasm in pursuit of a cause or an objective. All of these HBCUs have an upright zeal.
I like that word.
Yeah, all me right. Too.
Our goal for was to thank you for being a great listener and audience. And you too think about HBCU too.
Good job, Ms. Lark.
Well done, Ms. Lark.
Good job. Okay, guys. All right, let's
sit
back. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Lark. Students in 304. Great job. Let's give them another hand. Okay, before we call the next class, can we get some lights? And, you know, students. Mr. Palmer, can you get the lights, please?
What? Yeah. I don't have kids
coming.
I'll let
you know. Okay, here we are. Real important. I want to say this. Guys are being really good. Let's listen. And you guys are being very, very respectful for those coming up. Listen, it's not easy coming up, standing up here, getting in front of your peers. Okay, it comes easy and natural to us adults here because we're teachers and we're used to it. Okay, and over time, you know, we got used to being in front of people. Okay, so it's not easy. Sometimes it's hard, and that was brave of 304. You guys did a good job. It's a little easier for me when I was at Lincoln University and that college was mentioned. I went to Lincoln University right after high school. It's the HBCU. And I heard them say that it was one of the first, very first black colleges and universities in this country. So while I was there, our basketball team played another HBCU, which stands for Historically Black College Universities, Cheney University. It was a dispute between Lincoln University and Cheney University and who was the oldest. I hope I'm not stealing anyone's assembly, okay. So Cheney would say, no, we were first. We're the first black college in this country. And Lincoln said, no, we were. So Cheney was called Cheney Institute, and it was started here in Philadelphia by the Quakers. It was for black men, usually at that time. In fact, Lincoln University started as a college and university only for black men. And did you know that Albert Einstein taught at Lincoln University? Now, he wasn't my teacher because he's like really old, okay? I'm not that old. But he did. He taught there. It was known as a science university, and Cheney was known as a teacher's college. A lot of Philadelphia teachers came from Cheney, black teachers came from Cheney. They started as an institute, and I forget when they got their accreditation, but Lincoln University was first, and that's what we told them, and they still believe that they were first, but it was Lincoln. Okay. One more thing, they mentioned Hampton. I have to say this, a plug for my son. He went to Hampton University, which is in Virginia, and he is now an architect. My oldest son, he's an architect. So you can go learn some things. He's an architect in the Maryland, D.C. area. So without further ado, we are going to call the next sixth grade class, and you guys will be in grade room 305, Miss Cirillo, HBCU authors, and read aloud. And she has a recording presentation, and we're going to get the lights again for her. Thank you. No, we're going to, thank you.
But literally put it right in there. No, like this. Just do that. Audio file no longer exists.
What does that
mean? It means that you can't find the audio file.
Okay.
Great. Wherever it was.
Okay, can we do 310? I'll go get my computer.
Yeah, we can do that.
Okay. Sorry, we're having some technical difficulties. I'm gonna go get my computer. Ms. Petrasco, can we go with 310 first? I have to get my computer for this one. Sorry, boys and girls. All right, let's give 310 a round of applause.
Bring your back.
Okay, so 310, we have HBC mascot presentation. 310. We're going to wait for Ms. Petrasco.
Six people here are reading from 310. Come on.
310 folks, come on. Give him a hand.
This year's homeroom 310 decides to research on mascots. This year's homeroom 310 decided to research on mascots of some well-known historically black colleges and universities to find out how these mascots came up with their mascots. A mascot is an animal, person, creature, or object that represents a particular organization or school. For many schools, having a mascot gets the student body excited to represent one thing, to represent their school and be active members of the school community. One thing that isn't always known is how the school decided on their mascot. For some schools, it could be as simple as a school-wide vote like the Hampton University Pirates. For other folktales and myths are offered up as potential explanations. Today we will share six HBCU's mascots that have interesting origins that, unless you were a student there, you definitely didn't know about. The first school we researched was the North Carolina Agriculture and Technical State University, often called NCANT in Greensboro, North Carolina. The students NCANT are nicknamed Aggies. Since NCANT started out as an agriculture school, which means it started as a school to study farming, growing food. This school has a bulldog as their mascot. So why did a farming school pick a bulldog as their mascot? According to the legend, a dog was kept on school campus farm as help with the shepherding. Shepherding the animals. One night, a football game had everyone on the edge of their seats. The Aggies weren't doing well. Suddenly, an Aggie fullback mustered up the willpower, tore through the defense and scored. A referee flagged it, and after speculation, deemed it was no good. At the moment, someone let the dog loose, and it pummeled the referee. It is said the This incident almost cost the school its CIAA, a membership. But the Bulldog became the school's permanent mascot. The Bulldog's name is Aggie and sometimes referred as Aggie the dog. Aggie has a female counterpart, Agatha, and they can be seen at football, men's and women's basketball games and other university events.
Howard University in Washington, D.C. was the second school we picked. The Bison have been Howard's mascot since the 1920s. Although there is no funny story like the previous school, the chosen mascot was created around the time of the opening of the Howard University Stadium in 1926. Named for one of the American's first national mammals, the Howard Bison was chosen because of this animal symbolizes pride, history, resilience, strength, stadium, agility, and perseverance, which are qualities that many of the HU elements have since the 1920s. The Bison and Lady Bison have been represented the HU sports team and university in 2014. Howard has the opportunity to name one of the two Bison entering the National Zoo, Zora, named after famed author Zora Neale Hurston, was one of the Bisons to start the zoo's pure Bison herd. Recently, the Bison logo at Hurston changed because it looked very similar to the Buffalo Bills NFL logo. The new logo is updated with a modern, clean look that any student or alum would be proud to wear. The next school, Florida A&M University in Tallahassee, Florida, is the home of the Rattlers. There are two stories about how the school came to pick a rattlesnake as the mascot. The first story claims that after relocating the school campus to Highwood Plantation in 1891, the land was crawling with many different kinds of snakes, especially rattlesnakes, so it became the Rattlers. The second and more popular story tells another tale. The 369th Infantry Regiment was called the Black Rattlers during World War I and World War II. An infantry regiment is a special group of soldiers in the military who are specially trained to combat and fight in war. This infantry was known for being the first African-American regiment to serve during World War I. Some say that Florida A&M was named after this hardworking, honorable regiment of soldiers. The mascot's name is Venom, and he even has his own Twitter page. Venom the Rattler takes his green and orange colors from agricultural plants in the state's booming citrus fruit industry.
Our next school is Elizabeth City State University in Elizabeth City, North Carolina. This school is better known as ECSU. Back in the 1960s, ECSU was known as State Teachers College. The mascot was a pirate. When the school wanted to join the CIAA, the Central Intercollegiate Athletic Association, which is a college athletic conference mostly consisting of historically Black colleges and universities at the Division II level. They had to change their mascot because another university in the conference, Hampton University, already had the pirate as their mascot. In the 1963-1964 school year, ECSU picked the Viking because historically Vikings are known for growing their population through constant discovery and triumph of new territories. Similar to the ECSU Viking, many people come to the school to teach, learn, or discover. However, they graduate from the university to prepare with more important skills and supported by a network of family, friends, and community. The tagline, "Come to discover, leave to conquer," represents this journey. The mascot's name is Vic the Viking. Our next school,
school is in our own state of Pennsylvania. Lincoln University in Oxford, Pennsylvania is sometimes confused with the Lincoln University in Missouri. But these are two different schools. Our Lincoln, Pennsylvania has Lyon as their mascot. His name is Luther Lyon. The exact year the Lyon became the official mascot is not clear, but the first Lincoln University yearbook in 1931 was already called Lyon. In 1963, the student newspaper at the school, the Lincolnian, wrote an article about the Lyon mascot and wrote, it's interesting to note that when the Lincoln Men of the Year decided to select the mascot, they choose the highly symbolic lion. They were fully aware that this celebrated animal represented the epitome of masculine virtues and faltering aggressiveness, strenuous competition, and yielding strength in an enormous court.
Our last school is the University of Alabama. Their mascot is an elephant who was the origin of the mascot dates back to 1930. On October 8, 1930, a journalist wrote an article about the previous weekend's Alabama Ole Miss football game. He wrote that the Alabama team of 1930 was a machine, powerful, big, tough, fast, aggressive, well-schooled in fundamentals, and was best blocked for this team early in the season that I have ever seen. With those big points hit you, I mean you go down and stay down often for an additional 2 minutes. The journalist went on to creatively describe the momentum of the game, saying, at the end of the quarter, the earth started to tremble. There was a distant rumble continued to growl. Some excited fan in the stands bellowed, "Hold your horses, the elephants are coming," and outstamped the University of Alabama varsity team. Other writers and journalists would continue to refer to the Alabama as the Red Elephants, the red as a nod to the players' crimson red jerseys. And the name stuck throughout the years, which became a national championship season and bond. Even though this nickname became very popular, it would be nearly 50 years before Alabama recognized the animal and its official mascot. However, elephants would be memorabilia and had always seen on game day before it came to the official mascot. Throughout 1940s, for instance, the university kept a live elephant named Almite that was a regular sight on game days, and it would carry the year's homecoming queen onto the field every year prior to kickoff at the homecoming game. By 1950s, keeping an elephant alive year-round proved to be too expensive for the universities. Instead, UA Spirit Committee started hiring elephants, often from traveling circuses passing through today games, as well as other sports and big events on campus. He has a girlfriend elephant named Big Alice, who joins him sometimes. Big Al is one of the most recognizable and favorite mascots along colleges, and has to be named one of the best mascots in multiple times.
Good job.
Thank you, baby. Good job, 3-10. Give them another hand. Very good, very good, very good. I mean, I know it's probably rough feeding a rock waller, but can you imagine feeding an elephant? All right, so that was very informative, educational. Not only the mascot, learning about its origins and where they get it from, but also some of those colleges. And 304, also, some of those I did not realize were HBCUs, so thank you. So you're teaching me some things as well. Appreciate that. So we are about to go with row 305 as soon as Mr. Rillo gives me the green light, or you guys. She has a video presentation.
There you go.
And I believe she's ready. We're going to go.
Yeah. Yep.
Right. Thank you, boys and girls. colleges and universities. Together, we will explore some child-friendly books written by college and university students from Howard University in Washington, D.C. Then we will listen to a read aloud from one of these featured books. We hope you enjoy. Can we hear that?
And I'm Rita. And we're going to introduce the first book. Black Joy and Exclusive by Adrian Wahid Alami from Howard University.
This text is a beautiful book by Adrian Wahid, featuring reading presentation by Rita Holm, Kelly Kazoo, and Jamila Shabazz, and Lila. This beautiful book was introduced to the e-commerce user of the Office of Language. Images were shot from 2012 to 2018 at various school cultures and positive events include AfroPunk, Million Man, 2015, Dance Africa, and the East Moscow Students Protest in South Africa.
Hi, I'm Amy.
Hi, I'm Daniel.
And we're going to introduce the next book, Karen's Life and HBCU.
My family is connected, a rising junior author at Howard University. Join brothers and sister duo Henry and Hope as historically black colleges and universities are explaining the unlikely children narrative. The author states, my sense is hope is that this book encourages future generations to become HBCU scholars.
Karen Going to the HBCU is a children's book for elementary school students that explores the importance of historically black colleges and universities, written and illustrated by current HBCU students.
I'm Karen.
And I'm also Karen. And this next text is Mali the Birth Area of the Lucky Rainbow Cake
by David Harvard University.
This children's narrative takes the young reader on a journey through her life in a world of Lucky, the first book, Mala and the Lucky Rainbow Cake, tackles what is like being different in a world where everyone else looks the same.
This book is written for children, especially those who have a mixed heritage. This will be fitting in and or feel they are too different.
Exposing. This book also helps non-children of color embrace diversity. Exposing children to diverse content at a young age teaches them to interact with individuals from all sorts of backgrounds as they choose through their various life stages.
Hi, I'm Christian. And this next question is about 15 years of my mom, 21 year old Professor Craig from Howard University.
This text passes the first perspective of young men of color by specific 13 years of everyday life. Young boy dressed in their Sunday best running to catch a glass and throwing up to be teaching.
Each of Tony Mandino's Tenka is matched with a different artist, including recent Holdicott and Coretta Scott King Award recipients.
I'm Brian. I'm Alex Clark. Tony Mandino wrote using a Tenka poem called Tenka. Do you know it? Tenka is a Japanese poem consistent of five lines, the verse and third of which have five syllables, and the other seven making 31 syllables in all, and giving a complete picture of an event or mood.
And my name is Amir, and joined this week by 13 ways of looking at a brand book by Tony Mandino, 13 artists. Notice how each take that form and just go to the total syllables.
Thank you for your patience.
the sound.
Yeah, I can try to put it to the speaker.
Yeah.
One-Way Ticket by Robert U. Trujillo. Payday don't pay much. Every breath I take is taxed. The kind of life where I'll have to take out a loan to pay back other loans. Lazy, Hazy Days by Keith Mallett. Summertime on stick, forehead sweat and ice cream tears, hiding from the sun, waiting for the rain to come, cool us like Jolly Pop spray. My Soul to Keep by Sean M. We preachers, brothers, we are crawling your pews, splintered as Christ's cross, while Daddy skipped the gospel and sanctified side-eye lips.
David.
Do Not Enter by Kesha Bruce. Ashes, pepper sky, is a deserted landscape of breakdown buildings and cars propped up on cinder blocks where oak curled and warm. Street Corner Prophet by Brianna Hunt. Dreadlock halo crown, Jesus show up everywhere. In a black park, here in Anacostia, winter corners take us. famous Broken Bus Blues by R. Gregory Christie. Know how many times I've missed this broke down bus? Hardly catch my breath, running as fast as can be. Wait at this bus leaving. Brothers are going to work it out by Akua Holmes. We righteous black men control the soul of this hood, raise one blood's pride to be the kings that they are, crowned glory of our future. Cat at the Curb by Javaka Steptoe. Sandwiched between her and black radio tile, a cat with my life, not yet spent, contemplates life. Springtime days, bunched up like brandy. The charm by Tiffany McKnight.
That concludes our 3-to-5 Black History Month presentation on HBCU authors and our read aloud. We hope you enjoy. Thank you to all students in 3-to-5 for supporting us.
Sorry for the technical difficulties. Thank you so much for your patience. Can we give 305 one more round of applause, please? Thank you.
I just want to make sure you guys didn't get cut. All right.
Okay, very good, very good. We're going to go right away because it is getting almost that time. We have more than 30 minutes for lunch, but we want to get this done so that you guys can get down to lunch in a timely manner. So we're coming up with our 7th grade classes, 306, 307, and 308. Mrs. Lee, sorry guys, Mrs. Grafe and Mr. Swantek, take it.
Football game is halftime. From drum major entrances to storied dance teams, HBCU marching bands have helped to shape not only HBCUs, but the whole college marching band world in general. If anyone has seen the movie Drumline with Nick Cannon, you have already experienced the thrill of the HBCU marching band. After we watch the movie clip, we will share some of the characteristics from these bands 309.
Audio, you're gonna have to hold the microphone to the thing.
Yep.
Here. No, your computer.
Yeah.
There's a lot of static. Cheerleaders be like.
does an HBCU band feel a different role than the other marching bands? In a typical marching band, drum majors control the tempo and direct the field direction of the band. The HBCU drum majors from the of bands to the other. Miss Lee.
Oh my goodness.
I couldn't hear your voice.
Feature an instrumentation that highlights brass instruments to maximize sound and create a brighter musical tone. Snare drummers typically use a traditional military style sling drum instead of the harness drum typical of contemporary American marching bands.
Marching styles and drill techniques. The marching style of HBCU bands has been described as, quote, show styles, unquote. It represents the high step marching styles with addition of upper body swinging during field shows. HBCU bands perform geometric moves featuring a straight lines, and are filled with energetic dance routines known as breakdown.
Focus on performing musical repertoire reflective of the popular song of the day. This song has recently included a heavy emphasis on R&B and hip-hop chart toppers. HBCU bands are also known for punches, short musical pieces drawn from the melody of songs associated with popular cultures such as television and movie theme songs. During stoppages in gameplay, these will be performed in alternating sequences from the opposing band, with the ensembles able to perform the most without repeating any winning the battle.
on your computer, this would have been that awesome.
Hannah Lilly, HBCU bands use a distinct language style. Performances are called battles, while the energetic participation or approval of the crowd is known as house, and ensembles attempt to win house. Performing a punch is called throwing, as in throwing a punch. The Battle of the Bands is an annual invitational exhibition of HBCU bands that occurred each spring at our exhibition. Now we'll hear about the top 10 HBCU marching bands from other 7th grade students in room 306 and 308.
Pickering University Marching Wildcats. The Marching Wildcats are a 300-plus member unit that includes five drum majors, traditionally known as the Five Horsemen, and the 14-carat gold dancers, also known as the Pride. The band has been featured in numerous events, including televised performances. The Marching Wildcats is one of the largest collegiate marching bands in the country. Marching 100. In 1946, William P. Foster became director of bands at FAMU with 60 members and created what is known today as the most imitated marching band in America. He is credited with revolutionizing marching band techniques and reshaping the world's concept of the collegiate marching band. The textbook band pageantry is considered to be the Bible for the marching band. In 1967 and 1968, Grambling's band performed in Super Bowls 1 and 2, this respectively prior to the NFL championship game, being officially called the Super Bowl Grambling 1967 has been named one of the top 10 Super Bowl halftime shows by Sports Illustrated magazine.
Became the famous Pricey J7. The Pricey J7 inspired a new style of dance known as J7 that quickly grew in popularity nationwide.
The Norfolk State University Spartan Legion. Discipline and Spartan-like behavior is the key to the memorable honors that the Spartan Legion has won. Selected performances include, most recently, the Barack Obama presidential campaign rally in Norfolk, Virginia.
North Carolina A&T State University Blue and Gold Marching Machine. The history of the North Carolina A&T Marching Band can be traced back to the early 20th century. The Blue and Gold Marching Machine, also known as the BGMM, is the school's official machine band. The Blue and Gold Marching Machine performed free games and halftime shows at all North Carolina A&T, Aggies football home games and travel most away games. The band's auxiliary unit, also known as Golden Delight, is a combining unit that serves the purposes of color guard, button trolls, and dancers.
The Marching 101 is the official name of the marching band at South Carolina State University,
for almost 100 years. The ensemble has been delivering on their promise to transcend, conquer, and leave nothing to be desired in fall of 1964. The band debates its new name, the SC State Marching 101 Band. The Marching 101 maintains a fierce rivalry with a Florida A&M University Marching 100.
Southern University and A&M College Human Jukebox. The Human Jukebox is one of the most watched and followed collegiate marching bands in the nation, with over 130,000 followers on Facebook, over 40,000 followers on Instagram, and countless YouTube videos reaching over a million views. Accompanied by its famous dance team and dancing girls, the Human Jukebox have been named American number one marching band by USA Today. One of the most anticipated traditions of the Human Jukebox is the Friday night battle of the bands versus Grumpling Band during Bayou Classic Weekend in the Mercedes-Benz Superdome.
Tennessee State University Aristocratic Bands. In 1955, the Aristocratic Bands and A&B was the first historically black college and university, also known as HBCU Band, to appear on national television with their performance at the Chicago Bears versus Los Angeles Rams NFL game. In 1961, they performed for the inauguration of President John F. Kennedy, making them the first historically black college and university to perform at a presidential inauguration. The band is led by four teenagers known as the Fantastic Four and is accompanied by a sophisticated ladies dance team.
Texas Southern University Ocean Assault. The marching band at Texas Southern University was founded in 1969 by Benjamin J. Butler II. Since the name Ocean of Soul was given to the Texas Southern University band by a local radio show talking about a mountain of soul for Houston, it has commanded the interest and attention of the public locally and nationally. The flashy pace-setting Ocean of Soul have appeared at numerous professional performances.
This is a real B&H customer. We will highlight some of the best HBCU bands in the land. We're going to start with, we have the Marching 100 from Florida A&M. We have the Sonic Boom from Jackson State. Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Gates, and the three, Mrs. Crockett, Mrs. Grace. Let's give them another hand.
Welcome.
And we're about to have eighth grade come up. You know, the teachers, 300-301-302-307. Let's settle down as they get ready. They are doing famous alumni from HBCUs. While we're waiting, I just want to say these bands, particularly these black bands in the South, they're very competitive. They are like a sport team. A lot of the students, they get scholarships to come to these schools and perform. And they only operate to be perfect, perfection. As you saw, the first video that Miss Lee put up was from the movie Stomp the Yard. But that's how they are, very competitive.
If you have audio, put the mic right.
Okay, I have this is the representative right here, and we are ready. So we can get you guys some lunch. Enjoy. We're ready.
American television host, actress, producer, philanthropist. In 2005, Business Week named her the greatest black philanthropist in American history. Oprah Angel Network has raised more than $51 million for charitable programs, including girls' education in South Africa, and relief to the victims of Hurricane Katrina.
Kamala Harris, Howard University. Kamala Harris is an American politician and attorney who is the 49th and current Vice President of the United States. She is the first female Vice President and the highest ranking female official in U.S. history, as well as the first African American and first Asian American Vice President. A member of the Democratic Party, she served as the Attorney General of California from 2011 to 2017. And as a United States Senator representing California from 2017 to 2021, Harris became Vice President upon being inaugurated in January 2021.
Spike Lee, Morehouse College. Spike Lee is a notable writer, director, producer, actor, and author who revolutionized both the landscape of independent cinema and the role of black talent in film. Rightly regarded as a premier African-American filmmaker, many of his films are semi-autobiographical and involve African-American or racial themes, as these were things he witnessed growing up as a child in Brooklyn. Lee has won the Emmy Award and was nominated for 2 Academy Awards.
Samuel L. Jackson, Morehouse College. Samuel L. Jackson is an American actor who is especially known for his work in action blockbusters and is filmed with director Spike Lee, notably Do the Right Thing in 1989, and Quentin Tarantino in Pulp Fiction in 1994, and The Django Unchained in 2012.
Chadwick Boseman, Howard University. Chadwick Boseman was an American actor and playwright who became a highly respected movie star with several iconic roles, notably that of T'Challa and Black Panther in the groundbreaking film Black Panther, and Jackie Robinson in the movie 42.
Great.
Taraji P. Henson. Taraji P. Henson, Howard University. Taraji P. Henson started in Hustle and Flow and earned an Academy Award nomination for her role in A Curious Case of Benjamin Button. She has also won a Golden Globe for her role as Cookie on the TV soap opera Empire. Her later works include the critical acclaimed Hidden Figures 2016 and the role of Miss Hennigan in Any Life on NBC 2021.
Reverend Jesse Jackson, North Carolina A&T State University. Jesse Lewis Jackson is an American political activist, Baptist minister, and politician. He was a candidate for the Democratic presidential nomination in 1984 and 1988, and served as a shadow U.S. Senator for the District of Columbia from 1991 to 1997.
Michael Strahan, Texas Southern University. Michael T. Strahan is an American television personality, journalist, and former professional American football player. He played all 15 seasons of his career with the New York Giants of the National Football League. Since retiring from the NFL, he has become a media personality, appearing as a football analyst on Fox NFL Sunday and later serving as co-host of ABC's Good Morning America, as well as live with Kelly and Michael of Kelly and Rupa from 2012 to 2016, for which he won two Daytime Emmy Awards, plus guest appearances on game shows and other programs.
Jenny Rice. Jerry Rice, Mississippi Valley State. Jerry Lee Rice is a former football wide receiver who played in the National Football League for 21 seasons. He played college football in Mississippi Valley State. Rice was selected by the San Francisco 49ers in the first round of the 1985 NFL Draft with the 16th pick overall and spent 16 seasons with the 49ers. Rice is the career leader in both major statistical categories for wide receivers, including receptions, touchdown receptions, and receiving yards, once being the leader for total yards and touchdowns in the season. Stephen A. Smith, Winston-Salem State University. Stephen Anthony Smith is an American sports television personality, sports radio host, and sports journalist. He is a commenter on ESPN's First Take, where he appears with Molly Queen. He also makes frequent appearances as an NBA analyst on SportsCenter. Smith is also an NBA analyst for ESPN on NBA Countdown and NBA Broadcast on ESPN. He also hosts the Stephen A. Smith Show on ESPN Radio. Smith is featured columnist for ESPNNY.com. ESPN.com and the Philadelphia Inquirer. Now, here is a short video on other famous alumni of the HBCU.
Is that set up? Just press play. Is it? If it's set up, it'll work. But the, yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, eighth grade. That was very, very good. Very good, very good. I should have been in that slide, though. You know? Come on, man. Yeah, thank you, university. Anyway, that was wonderful. Before we leave, and we're not leaving right this minute, and I'll explain that in a moment. We can just sit back and relax. First of all, give yourselves a hand for being an excellent audience. A sixth, seventh, eighth grade. Very good, very good. Now, I just want to say, although February is Black History Month, but know that Black history is all of our history. It's American history.
Excuse me, folks.
Okay, and we learn it 365 days in a year. Okay. So, good job. It was very informative. All of the presentations, the reading, the slides. Very good. So here is the deal. For you guys, it will be outdoor recess, grade 6 and 7. Teachers, this is going to be up to you. They go outside, but not right now because we still have the second lunch recess going on. You have about 5 minutes. They can go, 6 and 7 can go out these doors when it is time. Eighth grade, I would suggest that you guys, you eat first, eighth grade. So teachers, if you want to go, I believe students are still downstairs, maybe, but in a few minutes, if you want to go out and walk them down the steps and go to the lunchroom. So let's just wait here about 5 minutes. Okay. Anything else anyone want to add? Eighth grade presenters, eighth grade.